Tom.
Hi, Joy.
Well, it's the time of the year where we really need to start reminding people that if you haven't booked your holiday travel and you haven't booked those spring breaks, you're really late. So the space is really limited. I think a lot of the calls that we're getting now are sort of people saying, you know, I'm looking at doing this, and, you know, you just don't have the luxury of having a lot of options. So if you're looking at going, we thought maybe we'd give you a couple of quick tips, and that might be to try to be a little bit flexible in terms of number of nights. There are some charters out of Lansing, but those are all sold out. Mm-hmm. They're not doing Jamaica. Sometimes about 60 days in, space might loosen up just a little bit as unsold seats go back in, but you shouldn't count on that.
Right.
But another thing that we just learned, Tom, is that when you look at the price of doing, say, a short cruise or even a week-long cruise with your family, in lieu of a holiday get-together, if you look at the cost and you look at what you spend just to even go out to dinner with a family of 12 or something, you can actually do a three-nighter with your family and make a lifelong memory.
Absolutely. It's much more exciting. Like you say, in the long run, sometimes it's more economical to do it that way. And the memories, you know, instead of passing out on the couch in front of the football game, you'll have a lot more wonderful memories than just that.
Yeah, and this is also the time of the year where a lot of the European airfares go down. There's a lot of airfare discounts. So if you're looking to, I like to encourage the nonstop to Paris. You can actually do Paris for, you know, 4 to 6 nights. It's a nonstop flight in, you watch a couple of movies, and I think the big mistake that people make is that they think they can't go to Europe unless they have 10 days or 2 weeks. And it's hard to plan to be gone that long, and it's also hard to plan for the expense of being in Europe that long.
Absolutely. And these nonstop flights make it so easy. We saw that when we flew to Rome. It's, you're on in Detroit and you're get off the next morning in Rome. It's, you can do it for under a week and do it comfortably.
Yeah. And speaking of that, I guess that sort of leads us into talking about the week that we spent in the south of Italy, which was in Naples in particular.
Right.
And we climbed up to the top of Mount Vesuvius, right up to the rim.
Yep.
And that was, of course, it's hot in Italy year-round. That's why the fall is so ideal, such a great time to go. You'll find a lot of European tourists traveling at that time of the year. But the issue there was that it was kind of emotional to be up there, you know, fifth most dangerous volcano in the world, and you're looking down at Pompeii, and then we turn around and it's steaming. It was like,
yeah, the steam vents were open. That was really exciting. And then they kind of morph into clouds, so it looks like it's an actual eruption from a distance. But
yeah
it's a little bit of activity up there, just enough to keep it interesting. And the hike, it's doable. It's about an hour in each direction, and it's on a path of crushed lava rock. So it's a little bit like walking on a rough beach. So it's not the easiest.
Some keens or good tennis shoes. The people that had their sandals on were really suffering.
Right. Yeah, it was a hard climb for them. But once you do get to the rim, there are, what, 3 or 4 little bars and gift shops?
Like there is everywhere.
So, you can stop, have a beer, glass of wine, and the walk down isn't so bad.
Yeah, and then the next day we took a public ferry over to Sorrento, and I really recommend Sorrento to a lot of people. As I said, when you're talking about doing southern Italy, if you're talking about doing Italy at all, you really need to seek out good advice because it can really change your experience there. And that's why we really wanted to be very entrenched in the southern part of Italy so we could do a better job for folks.
Right. And if you don't want to put up with the hubbub of Naples, Sorrento is a gorgeous town just at the beginning of the Amalfi Coast. And the ferry service over to Capri, I think they go every hour. And to Naples, the same thing. I was thinking, we loved our stay in Naples, but Sorrento would be a good call, too.
Well, and I think that's what's important. I think people think of Positano, which is great, or even Ravello, but it's so far away from everything.
Yeah.
You know, that part of what you love about traveling, at least when you have the quality of life that we do in this, you know, rural setting, is to be, have some activities.
Well,
how about
like
that
it?
Meal there?
Oh, wow, spectacular. I mean, did we have a bad meal? I can't remember one, but that one was great.
And the restaurant was?
Amelia.
Yeah,
at the Marina Grande.
It's a family-owned kind of place, very reasonable, right on the water.
Yeah, I mean, we watched them pulling the fish off the docks from there. It was a gorgeous meal.
Did another one of those sort of tram, hop-on, hop-off. Actually, didn't hop off on that one.
Right. But even the smaller towns these days have these hop-on, hop-off options. For an overview, you can't beat them. We've said that before.
And for people who like to sort of be independent travelers, which, of course, we do.
Yeah.
Well,
we do so much structured travel, escorting groups and cruises and that sort of thing, family travel, as stressful as that can be.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it's great just to kind of wing it for a while.
Yeah, you know? It was great, Tom. You did an excellent job planning it.
So it was easy.
Our time's up in this segment, so we want to tell everybody to stay tuned. We've got some great interviews coming up and our official news segment, which is Europe the way you want to do it. So stay tuned.
London is quite possibly the most global city in the world. Perhaps that's why Londoners have the Globe Theatre, where Shakespeare's plays were performed. And we can't forget about the Olympic Games either. London attracts 14 million visitors a year, which makes it Europe's most visited city. Out of all the destinations that I have ever traveled to, never have I encountered a city with so much history and so many different things to see. From Her Majesty's residence, Buckingham Palace, over to Piccadilly Circus, everywhere you go, it's easy to spot signs of British culture. Everything in London is either the biggest, the oldest, or the busiest. You could start with Big Ben, move over to the London Underground, the oldest underground train system in the world, and stop by Heathrow Airport, the busiest airport in the world. But make sure you don't forget about the London Eye, once the biggest Ferris wheel in the world. And if it's royal diadems that you fancy, the Tower of London is just the place. While London Bridge gets all the attention, it's nothing out of the ordinary. Tower Bridge is the photogenic masterpiece. Don't forget to pass by 10 Downing Street, home of the Prime Minister of the United Kingdom. And on your journey, take a look at the men in uniform along the way. And if you ever get a chance to take in England's capital, take a moment and remember how special life can be.
Okay, the blood drive is in a few days. Here's what you need to do to prepare your body for the best donation experience possible.
Start stocking up on iron-rich foods like green leafy vegetables, lean meats, nuts, and berries. Here's a list of iron-rich foods that you can eat. Also, avoid fatty foods a day or so before you plan to donate. Be sure to get a good night's sleep before donation day. Drink plenty of non-caffeinated beverages like juice or water before and after you donate. Be sure you eat breakfast, and don't forget about lunch if you plan to donate in the afternoon.
thanks for your help with the life-saving mission of the American Red Cross.
You are a hero.
Okay, we're back with part three of the Stout Family European Excellent Adventure. If you missed the previous show, which was on Normandy, I'd really encourage you to go online and watch that show, because it really, as our producer was saying, you know, gave her chills. And I think it's important for every American, and your photographs were so stunning. So you are back in Paris with your dad, Tim Stout.
Yes.
Your mom, the teacher.
Yep.
And you, and you're worried that he's not going to like Paris for the obvious reasons, and?
Well, the biggest thing is that I had been to Paris before, and even though it was only about 6 years ago, there was a little bit trouble with the language barrier, and there wasn't always a lot of understanding necessarily going on. And I had heard that as a little bit of a stereotype at times. And at that point, we had somebody...
Which doesn't bother you at all.
No.
Kind of adds to the ambiance,
sure,
right?
Sure, it is what it
is. You're worried when you're with your folks,
sure,
right?
Sure. And when we went that time, there was somebody in our group who spoke Spanish, so could maybe chop through a little bit of French.
No.
I am not that person, and none of us are. So we can barely get English out, let's say. So French is not an option. But I was amazed, actually, this time that the general mood towards a purely English-speaking person had changed, at least from what I was able to tell. It was great. Most people made a great effort. You know, you try to chop through the five words of French you know, and they immediately say, let's just go with English. But the city, I mean, I was... You know, I was worried about it. It's a different country, but it was great.
So stunning that
I'm
just so delighted that you made it a point to go with your parents, because it's a memory.
You could take an entire week there, and you could do an entire trip, and we really only had about a day, but we got them to climb the Arc de Triomphe, which elevator.
And oh my God!
We had to take a little breather at the top, but
oh
we got him up there.
So get him in the gym.
Yes, there's some pictures there from the.
If I've been panting.
The pictures of
down
us.
Down the Champs-Élysées.
Well, I think it's the best. If you want the best pictures in Paris, truthfully, I think you have to climb the Arc de Triomphe, because the picture of our family there with the Eiffel Tower in the background,
that's
where it's taken from, because you're up high enough. If you take the pictures from the Eiffel Tower, you can't see the Eiffel Tower.
The most iconic.
That's what you really want anyway, isn't it? You can get a picture, though, from the Arc de Triomphe with the Champs-Élysées and with the Tuileries in the distance with the Louvre, and then you can get the, you know, obviously the Eiffel Tower. So.
And then there's the whole Napoleon, you know.
I was amazed. What I think that what my dad was saying was most impressive to him as well was the Champs-Élysées. Every major top store, luxury, everything you can think of, all on one street with tons of excitement, tons of people, but very clean, which, you know, you don't always have that combination necessarily. And, you know, again, it didn't spend a ton of time there, but it was, he loved Paris. I think we could get him back.
Oh,
which,
my God.
Which, if you know him, is really saying something.
Hey, good for you.
And he loved the food. And he's a hot dog guy.
Oh, that's right.
Everybody knows that.
Oh, my God.
But he loved the food there as well. So
it just goes to show when you broaden your horizons,
that's right?
And then, you know, you feel like you can never get a good cup of coffee or a good piece of bread when you get home for about a month,
right?
So from Paris, you flew to Northern Ireland, right?
Yes.
Why did you do that, Tom?
Well, my mom had been to Ireland before and wanted to do something a little bit different, see something she hadn't seen. And truthfully, according to her at least, when she was there, Northern Ireland has a stigma of that's where you didn't go.
That was
the trouble,
that's the war, the terrorism,
you just didn't go there.
Now the people in Southern Ireland really don't want Northern Ireland to be part of Ireland. They can take care of them.
Well,
it's
written into the Constitution that the people of Northern Ireland, if they ever vote to become part of Ireland, Great Britain will cede it. But it's not close. So I don't think the power is truthfully in the people there, and you do see
it's
a divide.
Fascinating,
but it's I don't think it'll ever be Ireland.
I don't think so either.
And I don't think my mom really fully grasped that Northern Ireland is not the same country as Ireland when
and
you fly
you be
there.
Saying that about a teacher on television?
I think most people though have a little bit of confusion with regards
Absolutely.
To what it is.
Americans in particular are very uneducated about
it's true
geography and politics.
Well, and you think about it, and when you land, we flew into Belfast, and Belfast is really a city on the rise. Now, to be fair, with the terrorism and the problems, they were at the bottom. They had a ways to go, but we drove through. We rented a car there. We drove through the neighborhoods. You saw the IRA and the Catholic side and the Protestant side.
Oh, did you really?
The murals are still there.
Well, see, so
the
your
fences
mom was right.
Are still
it
up.
It was pretty.
Oh, it was
dicey.
Back it was very
in the day.
Bad, and it's really gotten a lot better. There's still, you know, a hint there. You can see the Republic of Ireland, the nation flags on one side, and you can see the Union Jack on the others, because technically it is the United Kingdom,
yeah,
and the money there,
like soccer.
The money there is the
well,
that's
right,
true. And the money is they use the pound. I mean, it's Great Britain. Queen is on everything.
I think
everything.
That's what people don't realize, that's Britain. And
well, what's amazing is that, I mean, we spent time in Northern Ireland, but when you straddle the border there. Most times you cross an international border, there's, you know, a passport, or there's at least a sign if it's an open border. There's nothing. You're driving along a road, and one gas station, you see that the price you have to pay is in pounds, and the next one you see is back to euros, and you say, I guess I crossed back into Ireland with this one.
Well, and that's what I want you to say, too, is that I don't think people really realize that Britain's still on the pound.
Yes.
And the rest of, well, almost the rest of Europe is on the euro.
Yes,
so
we had to get dual currencies to be able to go there. And the island itself, the island of Ireland, is only about the size of Indiana. But you cut off that top chunk there,
okay,
for Northern Ireland.
So would you recommend Northern Ireland?
Northern Ireland is absolutely beautiful.
Is it?
We went to Giant's Causeway.
Was your mom glad that she did it? Or?
Absolutely.
Okay,
I think she said she would say that was her favorite part of the trip. But you see, Giant's Causeway is a World Heritage Site. It's the basalt columns that come out. It's unique in the world for what it is. And, you know, they're taller than people. And it's individual rocks coming out. And it's really one of the natural sites in the world, and you see the beautiful countryside, and there's great golf to boot there as well.
And it's safe to drive and move around on your own, which is...
It is. You've got to drive on the other side of the road, just like Ireland.
Okay. Well, I think you brought up another point. It looks like we're going to have to do another segment just on golf.
I think so.
And I think that's always kind of
fun.
Who
doesn't enjoy that?
I certainly do. So if you stay tuned... we'll be sure to bring you the Stout Family Golfing in Ireland. And thanks so much for coming on, Tom, and I'll look forward to seeing you again. Okay, we'll be right back after this.
If you haven't donated blood before, or it's been a long time since you have donated, please come out. 97% of us will either need blood or know someone who needs blood in our lifetimes. That's almost all of us. Plus, blood is used for premature infants, patients battling cancer, people with sickle cell anemia, as well as many others. Did you know that less than 5% of the eligible population, meaning those that would be good candidates to donate blood, actually do? That's about 95% of people who could donate that aren't doing it. You never know when you or someone you love will need blood. Blood is perishable and only has a shelf life of 42 days. You can donate every 56 days, six times a year. Please come out and donate and give the gift of life.
Faith, we're kind of gearing down from one season to the next, so what are the cruises we shouldn't miss?
Well, Joy, we're just coming in the tail end of Alaska, and I know we're going to talk about that. But then we have our East Coast, where the fall colors, and that is just a magical cruise experience.
I did it.
Oh.
I recommend it to everybody. I stop people on the street and say, you have to do that cruise.
I'm all about the food and the colors. But when you can go to Nova Scotia and get the gingerbread, the hot gingerbread and cream.
And what about the lobster rolls?
Hello.
We had Really, that is a great trip. And as I said to someone, I would have never gone to Halifax. I would have never gone to Nova Scotia as much as I travel. I had never been to... Portland or Acadia, and it's just the only way to fly.
It's magical, because all of those ports of call that you just described bring you into historically a very maritime rich
world. I mean, that's where the old money folks are still hanging on.
I mean,
you know, if you're not old money, keep moving.
And there's just so much history also in with that. So you get. You get color, you get cuisine, you get the culture, and you get the history all in one exciting Fall Colors Cruise.
Well, I think what's interesting about Royal Caribbean, and you probably don't know this, but I do, is that you're the only cruise line that just does it for a week and round trip from Boston. So this means that you can get an easy airfare.
Yes.
You know, you don't have to do a pre or post night. You can get anywhere, and you don't have to take this huge chunk of 12 days and fly into New York and out of Quebec or something
exactly.
like that. So it's really something that I just really want to encourage everybody to take a look at. Please do this cruise. You'll thank me. And the one that I did with a balcony was under $700.
It's great.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I spend a week on groceries. So
I like
nice groceries. But in any case, thanks so much, and we'll be back and talk about some more discounts. So make sure you tune in every week for that.
Okay, the blood drive is in a few days. Here's what you need to do to prepare your body for the best donation experience possible.
Start stocking up on iron-rich foods like green leafy vegetables, lean meats, nuts, and berries. Here's a list of iron-rich foods that you can eat. Also, avoid fatty foods a day or so before you plan to donate. Be sure to get a good night's sleep before donation day. Drink plenty of non-caffeinated beverages like juice or water before and after you donate. Be sure you eat breakfast, and don't forget about lunch if you plan to donate in the afternoon.
Thanks for your help with the life-saving mission of the American Red Cross.
You are a hero.
The Royal Buzz today is how to take a cruise for free. You could be a group coordinator, and I bet if you had 16 friends or 8 double occupancy staterooms, that qualifies you for a free berth. You can use that for yourself, or you can spread that value all across to your friends. But that's the trick in learning to cruise for free. Call your Michigan travel agent, and they'll help you through that process.